The impression I got was that the military leadership convinced him that the war against the LTT could be won if political leadership gave a freedom to the military leadership without interfering and without imposing political agendas on the military agenda. And that was very clear in 2006, that was the transition. So then he allowed the military. Whether he was convinced of the military victory or not, we don't know. Then he allowed the military agenda without interference. And he also, I think his job, there was a very, you know, I think we must analyze, once again, dispassionately, right? That phase of Sri Lanka's war. Why is it that the military succeeded, whereas in the past, military did not succeed? I think one of the reasons is that division of labor between the military and political leadership. What did the political leadership do? Political leadership did three things. One is to create a kind of a political atmosphere in the country, so, you know, what was called at the time war footing. Secondly, to provide the financial and military resources to conduct the war long period of time. Third one is very important. That's to protect the military campaign from international and domestic criticism, right? And they didn't allow any foreign journalists to report the war. They didn't allow any local journalists to report the war. They didn't allow the human rights groups to criticize the human rights, you know, consequences of the war, right? They didn't allow any of the foreign NGOs to go to the north. You know, they did very, very carefully. They prevented any political criticism, any human rights criticism of the war. So the political leadership did those three things, right? So that succeeded. And LTT may have also contributed to the success of the government military campaign. You know, we have to once again dispassionately understand what kind of, you know, major strategic mistakes the LTT made. But I think what is important is that once the Mr. Rajapaksa won the war, you know, it changed the whole political, you know, equation. And he also realized, I'm sure ideologically at that time, there was this, you know, the nationalist mobilization, intensification of the singleist nationalist, you know, the euphoria. Even when early 1996, when Jaffna Peninsula was captured by the Sri Lankan army, there was a similar euphoria by the Chandrika Kumaratunga government as well. So then, of course, the military victory over the LTT was understood and interpreted as a political, you know, victory for the Sinhalese nation over the Tamil nation. So that kind of interpretation was there. And of course, you know, the Mr. Rajapaksa made use of that opportunity for other political purposes. You know, and once again, paradoxically, instead of opening up of Sri Lankan politics, instead of returning to democracy, instead of improving the human rights situation, actually Sri Lankan politics became worse after 2009 in the absence of the war.
Which you think he could have done to return back to
he could have done.
Or had he not changed by that time, or was it, by the time the war came to an end, do you think he had not changed, or was it...
You see, what is very paradoxical once again is that Sri Lanka's 30 years war altered the nature of the Sri Lankan state. But during the war, we didn't see it. We saw the war. But militarization has become normal. And only after the war, in the absence of war, we realized to what extent Sri Lankan state during the war had actually become militarized and had become authoritarian. It has become normal, actually. And we saw it only in the absence of the war. But during the war, we didn't see that.
Professor, to get to the final few questions with regard to the post-2009 period, you worked a lot on, most of your works since 2009 have been largely on state reform. with Prof. Nelvodi Mel, you published Reframing Democracy in 2012. Then in 2013, State Reform in Sri Lanka, Issues, Direction and Perspectives. One of the issues that you raise or continue to raise is this issue of nationalism, or perhaps rethinking some of the terms that we use to demand autonomy and so on. In a presentation you made, I think in 2014, which is published as Reconciliation After War, Thinking Beyond Solitudes, you critique these, I mean, both forms of nationalism. I just want to raise two questions about Tamil nationalism and single nationalism. With regard to the Tamil nationalism, the language that they use or continue to use, self-determination, is it something that is that continues to be divisive? Is it a question of language? I mean, because a lot of people argue that, well, you should abandon self-determination after 2009. But we can understand that particular term or phrase in various different ways. There's also politics to using that. It sounds divisive. It has a divisive kind of history also. How do you see this particular agenda of Tamil nationalism? Should they talk about self-determination in different terms, for example, or is it a valid sort of slogan that they should continue to use, perhaps, to talk about equality?
Yeah, it's also a difficult question, but let me share with you my own reflections. I think it's not merely a question of language, it's not merely a question of discourse. You see, in my writings, I try to develop an argument to say that nationalist politics, whether majoritarian or minoritarian, highlights some of the fundamental grievances that the community has been experiencing. But nationalism cannot provide an effective answer to any of those questions. So my argument is something like this: nationalist politics can highlight in a larger than life suffering, grievances, deprivations, injustices that any ethnic community has been exposed to. Right? It can do only that. It cannot provide solutions. Solutions, lasting and sustainable solutions, have to be democratic solutions, not nationalist solutions. I mean, that has been the point, even in that book, chapter on reconciliation, I've been trying to say. You see, nationalist politics forces us to think and act in isolation. And Sri Lanka is a very good example of that dilemma of nationalist politics, that paradox. At one level, it highlights genuine social, economic, historical, cultural grievances. But it doesn't offer solutions. The only solution it offers is the formation of a state. But formation of the state can be the beginning of a whole set of new problems, right? Not solutions. That's the whole experience of the nation state. Yeah. So that's why I've been arguing that, you know, national grievances require democratic solutions.
But don't you think
that's how the state reform argument is linked to this analysis?
But when you go through the historical demands of the Federal Party, for example, still nationalist, but with the Federalist approach,
and democratic as well.
Democratic,
that's why every nationalist demand based on grievances has a democratic content. That's why, you know, nationalist politics should not be dismissed merely because it's nationalist. You know, to understand the essence of political essence of nationalism, we have to go beyond the discursive terms of nationalism, go beyond the language.
Without really rejecting.
Yeah. Even the majoritarian singular nationalism, you know, tells us there's something really radically wrong with the situation. We need to be able to understand that. And then link it to a process of democratic dialogue, negotiation, and democratic political imagination. And democratic political imagination cannot be made in isolation. It has to be a, you know, collective exercise where we consider all ethnic communities are autonomous political communities, not just ethnic communities.
With regard to the point that you just raised, Professor, I mean, single nationalism. Now, we've many of us, perhaps, whenever we discuss this issue, what's striking is that perhaps the only critique that we level is against single nationalism. But you also argue that we need to look at both these nationalisms and sort of listen to what they're saying.
Can I give an example of that? You know, I was in some time ago, I was in Monaragala district and also in Batticalo district talking to Sinhalese people about federalism. In the eastern province, right, some of the, you know, it's a women's group, they asked me, now if Tamils and Muslims are given regional autonomy in the eastern province, what happens to the Sinhalese us? And that question enabled me to think about, critically think about the conventional model of federalism. And I began to reflect on that. I came out with, you know, the thesis of federalism within federalism. You know, so even Sri Lanka's conventional federalist discourse, as one of your initial questions very correctly indicated, that, you know, to federalism is within a province, right? I would say the province is given autonomy. But how about, you know, the regional minorities, local minorities and dispersed minorities? You know, the Sinhalese are a majority in the province, in seven provinces. But in the eastern province, they are a regional minority. In Batticalo district, they are a local minority. Right? In Vaunia, they are a local minority. And Tamils may be a majority in northern province. They are not a majority, they are a local minority in the western province. Muslims are like that. You see, actually, when you look at the ethnic geography of Sri Lanka or any other country, all communities are, in one occasion or another, a minority. Even the majorities are a minority. So that is why it is extremely important for us also to think about beyond the conventional federalism of, you know, territorializing, you know, in the conventional form, ethnic solutions. So that's why, you know, deepening of federalism, I call it in the deep federalism. We need to think in terms of deep federalism as a democratic solution to all ethnic communities, not a few.
Finally, Professor, with regard to the present position that we are in, the new leadership, how do you assess, I'll ask a very broad question before concluding, how do you assess President Maithripala Sirisena's victory, his entry as the leader of the country, and also his reformist project that he's promoting? And as we discuss, the 19th Amendment is being debated in Parliament. How do you sum up this entire post-2015 January kind of era?
Actually, Mr. Sirisena's victory and assumption of office as the president has marked a rupture in Sri Lankan politics. Rupture in a positive democratization direction. That's very important. Actually, he's the probably the only president who has not only advocated the abolition of the executive presidential system, also very committed to it. Whether he will succeed or not, you know, we have to know only tomorrow morning. Secondly, Sri Lankan politics for the past few decades has suffered enough, particularly democracy has suffered enough under strong leaders. You know, Sri Lanka's democracy historically requires a non-superman president, right? A president who would not identify himself with militarized authoritarian state. So Maithripala Sirisena, in a way, in a Hegelian sense, you know, a tool of history, you know, he's non-aggressive, fairly humble presence, you know, personality, has in a way introduced a style of governance that's more suitable for Sri Lanka's transition from the one phase of politics, that authoritarianism, to post-authoritarian democratic politics. In that sense, I think he is a very important symbolically.
And about the current project, do you think the problem lies with the fact that there's a legitimate president, certainly, but the parliamentary formation is still the old one and it's not...
Oh yes, actually, President Sirisena is confronted with a huge contradiction. That contradiction is that on 8th of January, he and the executive branch of the state received a popular mandate to reform the Sri Lankan state. But the parliament, the legislative branch of the state, is still the old parliament, which actually approved the 18th amendment, right? Which applauded Sri Lanka's transition to rapid transition to post-war authoritarianism. Now, this contradiction is not easily resolvable. Right? It's very, very difficult. Constitutional reform is ultimately the task of the legislature, not the executive. The executive branch of the state, headed by the president and the prime minister of the cabinet, can only propose state reform. It has to be approved by the legislature, by parliament. So parliament is deeply divided on that. You know, President Rajapaksha, or rather President Sirisena, does have a clear parliamentary majority, and opposition has a clear parliamentary majority. So that's the contradiction. That to what extent President Sirisena has been able to resolve that contradiction in favor of his reform project is not yet clear.
What would be the best? What would be the best option going forward? Let's say Parliament adopts the 19th Amendment, or it isn't. The best solution, the best...
Well, Parliament should adopt the 19th Amendment. Even then, President Rajapaksha, President Sirisena will face the challenge of having hostile, if not unfriendly, parliamentary majority, and that question has to be resolved. Only way to resolve that question is dissolving parliament and calling for fresh parliamentary elections. But in fresh parliamentary elections also, it's very difficult to expect any single party to have an absolute parliamentary majority. So next government is going to be a coalition government, which is not a bad thing. All Sri Lanka's governments in 1947 have been coalition governments. So we can have another coalition. But you know, some degree of regime stabilization is necessary. Because of this division between the legislature and the executive in terms of its relative strength, the regime stability is not yet clear.
Thanks, Professor. That's all we can discuss today. It was a privilege and a pleasure to actually talk to you. And thanks for being on SSA Talks.
Yeah, thank you very much for talking to me.